It's lovely to see you. Welcome to church. Let's just take a moment, shall we? Father God, as we welcome one another, we welcome you to have your way amongst us. Lord, thank you for each one of us. Thank you that you know us each by name. You know us each very intimately, very personally. And Father God, as we gather together to sing your praise, to listen and to be challenged by your word, to share Holy Communion together, Lord, we welcome you by your Holy Spirit. Lord, come and have your way amongst us, we pray. Amen. And welcome, of course, if you're watching on Zoom. Very nice that you are with us as well. So, are you ready? Get your middle finger ready. This is the new day that God has made. For life and for breath, we say thank you, God, for giving us our very life, for giving us our breath today. And if you're struggling with your breath and coughing, please, God, can we have a bit more? You're welcome, Alan. We're going to use these words that are up on the screen. So God in Christ has revealed his glory. Come, let us worship. From the rising of the sun all the way to its setting, the Lord's name is greatly to be praised. So give him praise, you servants of the Lord. Oh, praise the name of the Lord. Father God, your Son has opened for us a new and a living way into your presence. Wow. So give us new hearts. Give us constant wills to worship you. How? In spirit and in truth. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. I'm sure you'd like to know that it's the 16th Sunday after Trinity. Aren't you glad? Absolutely. This psalm is set by the Anglican Church for today. Psalm 19. The very heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of his hands. Day after day, they pour forth speech. Night after night, they reveal knowledge. They have no speech. They have no words. No sound is heard from them. Yet their voice goes out to all the earth. Their words to the ends of the world. In the heavens, God has pitched a tent for the sun, like a bridegroom coming out of its chamber, like a champion rejoicing to run his course. It rises at one end of the heavens and makes its circuit to the other. Nothing is deprived of its warmth. And the last verse, verse 14. So may the words of my and the meditations of my be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. What fabulous words. So Lord, may the words of our hearts today, the meditations of our hearts, the words of our mouth, our praises and our prayers, may it all be pleasing to you this day, Lord, we pray. Amen. So, still on Amazing Grace. We're having 2 weeks on each of our values. Remember our brick, our grace. So we're going to start by singing. Even. This is Amazing Grace. So if you're able, why don't you stand with us and let's sing. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness?
Thank you.
Join with the angels today in that never-ending song of praise. Holy, holy, holy. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive all glory and honor and praise. And we join in that refrain today. We bring you all of our worship. Thank you. Amen. Take your seats for a second. Well, it must be time to hear from God's word. Must be. Monica is going to bring us our first reading today. It comes from Romans 5, verses 1 to 8. And it will, hopefully, be up on the screen.
First reading can be found in the Bible, in the Church Bible, in page 1132. It's Romans 5, 1 to 8. And hope. Therefore, Since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into his grace in which we now stand. And we boast in the hope of the glory of God, not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance, character, and character, hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. You see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. This is the word of the Lord.
But God demonstrated his amazing grace and love that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. What amazing grace. What amazing grace. We're going to just spend a few moments just thinking about that reality as we bring our hearts and ourselves before God in our confession today. Thank you, Lord. So Jesus said, repent, turn around, in other words, for the kingdom of heaven is close at hand. So let's turn away from sin. Let's turn to the Lord and confess our sins in penitence and in faith. So God, our Father, today we come to you in sorrow for our sins. Lord, for turning away from you, for ignoring your will for our lives, we pray, Father, forgive us, save us and help us. Lord, for behaving just as we wish, without thinking of you, we pray, Father, forgive us, save us and help us. Lord, those moments when we fail you by what we've done, what we've thought, and what we've said, we pray, Father, forgive us, save us and help us. Lord, for letting ourselves be drawn away from you by all the temptation that's in the world around us. Father, forgive us, save us and help us. And for living as if we were ashamed to belong to your Son, Father, forgive us, save us and help us. And may the God of all healing and forgiveness draw you to himself, cleanse you from all your sins, that you may behold the glory of his Son, the Word made flesh, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Just for a moment, as our eyes are closed, if you're happy to do so, why not just open your hands to God, just as we've opened our hearts to him and brought our confession. Lord, as we bring ourselves before you today, as we open our hands, we open our hearts to you afresh. Lord, we offer you ourselves. And Lord, we receive from you today afresh, Lord, your healing and your renewing and your remolding. Lord, speak your word afresh to our hearts that it might overflow from our lips. We welcome you, Holy Spirit, to continue your work of transforming our hearts and lives from glory unto glory, we pray. Make us more like Jesus, we pray. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Amen. Bet you're dying to know what our collect prayer is, aren't you? I'll tell you. It's this: Lord of all creation, whose glory is around and within us. A bit like the psalmist, isn't it? Open our eyes to see your wonders. The psalmist said, the heavens themselves shout, look at God. Lord, your glory is around and within us. Open our eyes to your wonders, that we may serve you with reverence and know your peace at our life's end. Not just yet, hopefully. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. So continuing our theme and what we've been thinking about building our lives on good things. We're going to spend a little bit of time in worship. We're going to sing, Build My Life. I will build my life upon your love. Because it is a sure foundation. And then it just works very nicely into Christ alone. You are our cornerstone. So let's remind ourselves through our worship what we're thinking about before we invite Mr. Mountford to come and bring us God's word today. So let's stand together if you're able. And let's spend a bit of time in worship.
Thank you. Amen.
Amen. Oh, you can take your seat. Thank you, God. We're going to hear our second reading for today. It's from Matthew's Gospel. Gloria's bringing it to us. Gloria's not bringing this to us. Come on down, Gloria. You can always read it off the screen. So Gloria, taken by surprise, is going to read us. Fantastic. Thank you, Gloria. You're super. Go for it. Thank you.
Then Peter came to Jesus and asked, Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother when he sins against me? 7 times. Jesus answered, I tell you not 7 times, but 77 times. Therefore, the King of Heaven is like a king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. As he began the settlement, a man who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. Since he was not able to pay, the master ordered that he and his wife and his children and all that he had be sold to repay the debt. Word of the Lord.
Oh, super. Okay, so that was the abridged version. I don't know where the other half went. Come on, Rob, let's pray for Rob as he opens up God's word to us today. Let's pray. So, Father God, we thank you for Rob, and we're trusting that you have laid your words on his heart for us today, that you've inspired him as he's prepared by your Holy Spirit. So, Lord, would you now, Lord, give us ears to hear from you through Rob today. Thank you, God. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. Well, hands up how many are hoping for an abridged version of a sermon this morning. Good morning. It's great to be back with you. A few weeks, actually, since we were here, Sue and I led a Methodist Heritage pilgrimage back in August for some of Staffordshire senior church leaders, which was great fun. And then we've been on holiday. In fact, while we were on holiday in Cyprus, we went, as we always do when we're there, to the ruins of the great Roman city of Paphos, which is absolutely incredibly huge site. Still a lot to be excavated, but what has been excavated is amazing. The sort of outline of the houses, the foundations, the pillars, and all over these incredible mosaics on the floor, these incredible tiled pictures that are real works of art that are still there. And while we were there one morning before the incredible intense heat of the day, we did ask each other, I wonder what happened to this city, why this incredible huge site sort of came to ruin, came to be like it is today. And then we read on a notice board that this whole city had been destroyed by a series of earthquakes in the 3rd century. So we went back to our holiday rest and relaxation, went to bed that evening, and about 12:30, rudely awakened by the whole bed, in fact, the whole bedroom, shaking violently. And we were caught up in an earthquake, which sort of took us back to the 3rd century in a sense, although we know why the city fell down. Thankfully, 21st century foundations were obviously a lot more strong than 3rd century ones, and there was no injury or anything that happened as a result of it. It was apparently a 4.9 earthquake that happened just off Paphos. In fact, you didn't even know about it, did you? It didn't even make the news because no one was injured. But while we were there then, we were getting pictures from home. Our son and his wife are having an extension at their home here in the city. And because the ground falls away to the side of their house, of course, the extension's going to have to be built on solid foundations. So we were getting these photographs of trenches that were more than 6 feet deep, because they could stand in them. So deep have the foundations got to be to make sure that when that extension is built, it's not going to fall down. Foundations are really important, aren't they? Foundations are hugely important. And for us here at St Paul's, as we know, those of you who've been here, we're thinking about some of the foundational things that that will bring St Paul's safely and in a blessed and wonderful, growing, developing way into the future. And this first foundation, as shown on the brick behind me here, the foundation of grace. And I think last week, as you celebrated Lottie May's baptism and so on, Dave was sharing with you about the importance of God's grace, that we don't climb up to heaven, as it were, to get God's favour. But in Christ, God came down to us in the amazing grace of God, while we were still sinners, Christ dying for us. This is the reality of our lives, that we live with the awful tension and challenge and temptation of sin all the time, those things we think or speak or do, those tendencies, those addictions, those somethings that grab hold of us that we wish we didn't or weren't and couldn't, but seem to hold us. And then only through the grace of God in Jesus Christ can we find forgiveness and salvation and freedom from those sins. We've been singing about it this morning. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, that you would lay down your life that I might be set free. Oh, I sing for your love for me. Then Monica read to us in Romans 5, but being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. This is the wonderful joy of being a Christian. And that New Testament reading ended in Romans 5:8. God demonstrates his own love for us in that while we were still sinners, a bit later on in Romans, it talks about God loving us even while we were his enemies. Even while we were his enemies, Christ died for us. So now we receive God's forgiveness by his grace. We put our trust in him, find forgiveness, find peace with God, and through the Lord Jesus Christ, this is the absolute foundational building block of our Christian life and faith. This is who we are in Christ. And if by any chance anyone here today has never come to that place, great news, today could be the day when you come and find that peace with God through the Lord Jesus Christ. We'll give you opportunity a little bit later to do so. But then our gospel reading that we had an abridged version of today focuses on the outworking of God's grace now, not only to us, but through us to each other. Because just as we've been forgiven because of God's amazing grace, because our sins have been forgiven, now we are compelled by the love of God to extend that grace and forgiveness to each other. As we have received grace, so we become the conduits of God's grace. As it says a little bit earlier in Matthew's gospel, Jesus put it, freely you have received, freely give. And so while on the one hand we celebrate all God's amazing grace to us, we feel the call and the compulsion that from that place of grace, we are to forgive each other. Gospel reading, Simon Peter, as we heard, thought he was actually being quite clever. You know, Simon Peter, who was never backwards in coming forwards, was he? Lord, look how wonderful I am. I'm even willing to forgive my brother 7 times when he's, you know, that these. And of course, Peter didn't get on too well with all of those other disciples, did he? And so often they were arguing with each other. Goodness, look at me. I've forgiven somebody 7 times for the wrong they've done. And obviously, if the text had carried on the screen, we'd have heard that incredible story of Jesus, where he told them a parable, a story with an absolute point to it. And he said there was a man whose servant owed him what we would say in modern English, millions and millions of pounds, a debt he could never repay. And so the master said, send the man and his wife and his family to prison, sell everything he's got until the debt's paid. Then, as the story goes on, the man comes and begs his master, his lord, and says, have mercy on me, I could never repay this. And the master took pity on him and forgave him his debt. Shortly afterwards, the man who'd been forgiven found someone who owed him, shall I say, £100, a tiny amount in comparison to the amount he'd been forgiven. And this servant now says to him, will you forgive me? But the man who's been forgiven millions of pounds won't forgive somebody £100. When other servants in the household saw what was going on, they thought this was terrible. How can someone who's been forgiven so much now be so stingy, nasty, when it comes to forgiving other people? In fact, they won't do it. And so, as the story ends, the man who'd been forgiven originally now is put in prison because of his terrible behavior. As far as God is concerned, that having been forgiven, he won't forgive somebody a lesser sin. Then the passage ends with this very incredible challenge. This is how my heavenly Father will treat each of you unless you forgive your brother or sister from the heart. Ouch. But from God's perspective, from God's logic, when he's forgiven us so much, then his call, his expectation upon us is that we will forgive each other that which we have offended each other by. I remember a little bit earlier, you know this only too well, earlier in Matthew's Gospel, than that passage, where the passage Matthew 6, the Lord's Prayer, as we often call it, and we pray it every week, and no doubt we'll probably pray it in a few moments, and we come to those words that say, forgive us our sins or our debts, as we forgive those who sin against us. That's Matthew 6, 12. And just in case we didn't get the message, even then at the end of Matthew 6, the Lord's Prayer, the next two verses are, for if you forgive other people when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive other people their sins, your Father will not forgive your sins. Double ouch. But this is God's logic, God's perspective. He grants us the incredible blessing of forgiveness for our many faults and sins. When we come to him, forgive us, Father, we know that he will forgive us, and yet we're called then to extend that forgiveness to others. In fact, we can read the words of Jesus to say, if you don't forgive others their sins, you won't be forgiven. So, huge challenge upon us. In practice, of course, forgiveness can be really challenging. Everybody can think forgiveness is a great idea until we've got something to forgive. And the bigger the thing we've got to forgive, the more challenging it is. I don't want to belittle the fact, the challenge of forgiveness. It's one thing to come and say to someone, oh, I'm sorry I'm late, forgive me. It's another thing to come and say something much more serious. You know, I've been drink driving and I've killed somebody or whatever it may be. It's like, wow, the forgiveness needed on that occasion is hugely different than the forgiveness needed somewhere else. However, the call of the gospel is to receive the grace of God, to know his forgiveness and blessing, and to come to that place where we forgive others, just as God in Christ forgave us. By way of illustration, the Ten Boom family were a Dutch family of clockmakers back in the 20th century. And when the Nazi Germany invaded the Netherlands in May 1940, the Ten Boom family took this incredibly brave decision that they would hide in their homes some Jews to enable them to escape being deported in the Holocaust. Incredible brave decision. Eventually, the family was betrayed, arrested, and sent to the Ravensbrück concentration camp. So in her book written after the war, The Hiding Place, Corrie ten Boom wrote about the incredible, terrible time in the concentration camp, about the horrific conditions, about the death of her beloved sister Betsy, and yet how she found the love and forgiveness of God in the middle of that hell on earth, and how the Lord saved her. So after the Second World War, she became quite a well-known Christian speaker, speaking about her experiences. And we're just going to watch, or rather listen to, a two-minute video clip of Corrie speaking about one particular example, instance of something that happened in the years following the Second World War. So she speaks in a very heavy Dutch-English accent, but thankfully there's text on the video so that you should be able to follow it, even if you don't pick up every word that she says. So let's go for it.
It was some time ago that I was in Berlin. And there came a man to me and said, "Ah, Mr. Baum, I am glad to see you. Don't you know me?" And suddenly I saw that man that was one of the most cruel overseers, guards, in the concentration camp. And that man said, I'm now a Christian. I have found the Lord Jesus. I read my Bible and I know that there is forgiveness for all the sins of the whole world, also for my sins. I have forgiveness for the cruelties I have done. But then I have asked God grace for an opportunity that I could ask one of my very victims forgiveness. And Fräulein ten Boom wants me forgiven. Will you forgive me? And I could not. I remembered the suffering of my dying sister through him. But I was not able, I could not, I could only hate him. And then I took one of these beautiful text, one of these boundless resources, Romans 5:5. The love of God is shed abroad into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who is given to us. And I said, "Thank you, Jesus, that you have brought into my heart God's love through the Holy Spirit who is given to me. And thank you, Father, that your love is stronger than my hatred and unforgiveness." That same moment, I was free. And I could say, "Brother, give me your hand." And I shook hands with him. And it was as if I felt God's love stream through my arms. You never touch so the ocean of God's love as that you forgive your enemies.
Wow. Did you notice the quote in the middle that she picked on, that she took, was from the reading that Monica brought to us earlier from Romans chapter 5, verse 5, that love of God is shed abroad or spread abroad in our hearts by the Holy Spirit who's given to us. From that incredible holding on to the Bible as the Word of God, found that forgiveness and came with this wonderful message: you never touch the ocean of God's love as when you forgive your enemies. So here now, 21st century Stoke-on-Trent, we have developed being hurt and upset to an art. We even have our own word for it, the word sneeped, that you never hear anywhere else. But I know I've sneeped people in the past. I've lost whole families from church because I've spoken to somebody and they've become sneeped and the whole family disappears and so on. And so we understand what it is in the potteries to be heard, and of course some of that is trifling stuff, some of it very much not so. But our question this morning is, are we hurt or upset? Are we sneaped? Have our feelings been hurt? Has somebody genuinely offended us in some way? Could be that we've held on to a grudge for many years. Remember in the 1980s, when I was a pastor in a church in Penkel, we had a gospel mission. And hundreds of people came through the church doors, and one family, an older lady with her daughters, came to the Lord. And out of that, out of finding the forgiveness of God, this old lady, who must have been in her 80s, I'm guessing, had to confess to her daughters that the oldest daughter was not the daughter of the father, but was the daughter of an affair that had happened in the Second World War. And she'd kept that something sort of like hidden for these 40 years, and all these three girls thought that they were all three genuine blood sisters, if that makes sense, rather than the older one being the product of an affair. It was an incredible thing just to witness in that family the grace of God as the mother asked for forgiveness and so on. And the incredible change in that dear old lady who'd held on to that something for so many years, who now, in asking for forgiveness and in finding forgiveness, was released, and her whole life was changed. Her countenance lit up as she let go of that thing which had been held on for so long. So this morning, our two questions, I guess, from the New Testament reading. Have we received the grace of God? Do we have an assurance that our sins are forgiven, that we are at peace with God because of what Jesus did for us? And from the gospel reading, do we need to forgive someone from the heart, and in forgiving others, not only find forgiveness for our own sins, but find an incredible freedom, a release for ourselves? Just as Corrie ten Boom said, as she forgave, what she found, the knowledge, the certainty of the love of God for her. So what we're going to do, we're going to, have a time of worship. And what I'm going to do, I'm going to exit right as opposed to exit left. And I'm going to walk behind those, the blue, what do I call them? The blue screens, that'll do. Actually, there's no tables behind the screens this morning, there's just chairs. So I'm going to step over there, and there's an invitation as we worship. If you're brave enough that you know you need God's forgiveness, or that you need someone just to pray with you, that you would find the grace to forgive others, then this is your opportunity this morning. As ever, our church times are not just times of information, of head knowledge, but of really meeting with God and finding his grace with us. So I'm going that way. I'm happy to be alone, but more happy if others come and join, that we find God's grace together in receiving and in giving forgiveness, and thereby working out, living out the grace of God.
Feel free to move around as we just use this in this lovely old song. I declare that I believe in Jesus, and I believe you died and rose again. I believe you pay for us all. You're here with the power to heal, that last line, and the grace to forgive. So as we use this song, feel free. If you want to get up, if you want to go use that space over in those chairs, someone will come and pray with you. So please feel free to do that.
I believe he is the Son of God.
thank you for your amazing grace for us. And Lord, would you help us,
Lord, to grow in grace. Help us to grow
in being bearers
and carriers of your grace. We just prepare to move on and to share and hold the communion together. Please join me.
We're going to use
this clip on the screen. It's only by grace, that lovely song Graham Kendrick wrote quite a few years ago.
Only by grace can we enter, and only by grace can we stand.
So please join
in with this clip as I
thank you. opportunity. Forward to receive Holy Communion. God is stirring something in you. Take that opportunity while you're up out of your seat. Once you receive Holy Communion, goodness that the Lord is here.
His Spirit is with us.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let's give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is right to praise you. You are Lord, Father of all creation. In your love, you made us for yourself. When we turned away, you didn't reject us, but you came to meet us in your Son. You embraced us as your children and welcomed us to sit and eat with you. In Christ you shared our life that we might live in him and he in us. He opened his arms of love upon the cross and made for all the perfect sacrifice for sin. On the night that he was betrayed at supper with his friends, Jesus took bread. He gave thanks. He broke it and he gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. So do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His body is the bread of life. At the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave you thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. So do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His blood is shed for all. As we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising in glory, send your Holy Spirit that this bread and this wine may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son. As we eat and drink these holy gifts, make us one in Christ our Lord. Absolutely. With your whole church throughout the world, we offer you this sacrifice of praise. We lift our voice to join the eternal song of heaven as we say together, "Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest." As our Savior taught us, so we pray together, remembering perhaps particularly those very poignant words about forgiving as we are forgiven, as we forgive others. So our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Amen. So we break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body because we all share the one bread. So draw near with faith. Draw near and receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Eat and drink and remember that Christ died for you. Feed on him in your hearts by faith and with thanksgiving. If those that are assisting today could come up first, and then remember, if we fill up the curve, receive your bread, and then we're all going to take it together. Thank you, Jesus. The body of Christ broken for you. The body of Christ broken for you. Thank you, Jesus. blood of Christ shed for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. Thank you, Lord.
Was a wretch, I remember who I was. I was lost, I was blind, I was running out of time. Sin separated, the breach was far too wide. But from the far side of the chasm, you held me in your sight. So you made a way across the great divide. Left behind heaven's throne to build it here inside. And there at the cross, you paid the debt I owe. Broke my chains, freed my soul for the first time.
Thank you.
Post-communion prayer for today is this. Lord of all creation, whose glory is around and within us, open our eyes to your wonders, that we may serve you with reverence and know your peace at our lives' end. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. John has got a few things, a few notices to bring to your attention. So come on down, John.
Forward a bit.
Yeah, okay. Morning. First of all, thank you to Dave and Robert for the service this morning. To Monica, Gloria and Marilyn, music team. Elizabeth and Alison on the desk, Jean and Paul on welcome, and Chrissy and Jill doing teas and coffees. On 7:30 this week, on Tuesday evening, we have whole prayer time in the meeting room. At 10:30 on Wednesday, we have open house, followed by seated exercise. Also, 12 till 1 and 1 till 2, we have reading friends with Anne in the meeting room. 9:30 this week is the first week of Super Tots playgroup. If anyone is interested, please see Amy. Next week, morning worship will be with Sue Mountford and Barbara Burton. Reminders. Open house on the 25th will also include the McMillan coffee morning. Donations and cakes would be welcome. On Saturday the 28th at 6 till 8 in the evening, we have a Harvest Fund family quiz being held in the hall. All are welcome. Free entry, but please bring a tin or a packet of Harvest or a Harvest packet for Harvest donation. And please register your interest. And bring your own drinks and snacks. That'll be prior to the actual Harvest service, which will be on Sunday the 29th. Once again, any donations of food will be greatly appreciated. And tea and coffee will be served afterwards. Thank you.
So if God has been speaking to you today, and if you've still not had the opportunity to respond and you'd like someone to pray with you, please take that opportunity at the end of the service. Don't shoot off. Just come and do business with God and sit a while with him. And you're most welcome to do that. Thank you. As always, thank you for your generosity. Thank you for your offerings. It is really appreciated. Thank you to those that give in all kinds of different ways. It is really appreciated. So thank you very much. Let's just bring those offerings. And just like those bread and fish that were offered before Jesus, with which he did an incredible amount, let's pray this prayer together. So gracious God, accept these gifts and with them our lives, to be used in your service through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So before we go on our way rejoicing to go and have a cup of tea, we're going to sing one more time about Amazing Grace, because we move on next week to our next brick. There's the teaser. I'm glad Alex is excited. Ooh. So we've done our first G, Grace, our next G. But you'll have to wait till next week to find out what it is. So if you're able to stand, let's sing Amazing Grace. My chains are gone and I've been set free.
Amazing Grace.
So may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your heart and your mind in the knowledge of the God who loves you. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you this day and always. Amen. Once we've had a cup of tea, then we will go in peace. To love and to serve the Lord and be carriers of his grace. In the name of Christ. Amen.